That's one thing. The other thing is we also ordered shirts that say Stop Genocide in Sudan, and we're going to be selling those for about $12. If you're interested in that, come see me outside after class. And I believe that's it, and we're just going to be meeting after class. So
okay, thanks.
Hope you can help.
Thank you.
One last one.
We have too many announcements today. But just a reminder for my talk next week on post-Holocaust literature. There are two short.
Last spring,
600?
Maybe 1,000.
There were approximately 30,000 Jews who took place in partisan units all over Eastern and Western Europe. According to the dictionary, and you'll see this in a sec, a partisan has two definitions. The one we're mostly used to is related to partisan politics, right? So it's a fervent, sometimes militant supporter or proponent of a party, cause, faction, person, or idea. A partisan is a member of an organized body of fighters who attack or harass an enemy, especially behind occupied territory, a guerrilla. I'm going to show a short clip, around 7 minutes, and this will tell you a little bit about the partisans, and then we'll come back and talk a little bit more about this. So if we could play this clip from the beginning, please, chapter one from the beginning. We'll be set.
These are the images that come to mind when people think about the Jewish experience during the Holocaust. But these are not the only images. There were 20 to 30,000 Jew-known freedom fighters conducted thousands of acts of sabotage against their Nazi oppressors. They were known as Jewish partisans.
People did not go only like sheep to their death. People were fighting every which way they can.
I did my job the best I could. I was in many battles, sometimes maybe 100 feet away. And bullets were flying all the sides. And luckily, I survived.
Let's say a German column was marching to us. He ambushed them.
The partisans, they fought for freedom, for a better tomorrow, for a better future. And they fought in order not to be eliminated.
Jewish partisans were responsible for the liberation of thousands of Jews trapped in ghettos, saving them from annihilation.
I started to organize an escape. I had 55 people, so they were willing to escape. From the 55, 30 were killed. 25 made it into the woods. Without the forest, we couldn't survive.
The trees, the sky.
Because in the day, we couldn't go, in the night. If there was a moonlight night, we couldn't move. So the night, the blizzard, heavy snow, heavy rain. This was our friends.
Jewish partisans committed thousands of acts of sabotage, significantly impeding the Nazi war effort.
We were interested in getting involved in sabotage acts.
From revolvers and rifles and machine guns. We overpowered them, so little by little their shooting stopped.
We had to blow up with rain until it was sitting in the background and waiting till the train approached and some of the Germans got killed.
It's the same to Jews as it is to Americans to study the Revolutionary War and its heroes, right? People put their chest in front of English muskets to build a country. We put muskets to defend ourselves from annihilation and maybe prevent the death of other Jews.
And I was going to get killed, I was going to get killed as a fighter. Not because I'm a Jew.
I survived for two legacies. For revenge in telling the story. Revenge for my father and telling the story for my mother. So if I had the chance, and if I looked for resistance, this was the most important thing for me. And I would be killed, if I wouldn't be killed, I had to do it.
There's such a thing as fighting back. This is the way I think. That's why I'm sitting here to give you the interview. Why else would I do it? I want the people to know that we were fighting.
Classrooms all over the country. The foundation is developing innovative educational materials available on the internet from a series of original interviews gathered from all over the world. The Jewish Partisan Educational Foundation, celebrating the unsung heroes of the Holocaust. For more information, go to www.
The Nazis knew about it, and only 60 people survived, including this woman. When they ran out of the tunnel, there were people waiting there with guns for them, and she got very lucky to survive. So that was very interesting. It was more than just fighting. That there were people who were also saving Jews. And in fact, many Partisan groups were doing that. Any other questions? Any thoughts about the video before we go on? Yes.
Were all the groups connected, or were they separate?
That's a great question. Were all the groups connected or not? And they started moving east. So the Germans were moving east, and they eventually got as far as Stalingrad. Well, what happened was, is that when they attacked, you had literally hundreds of thousands of Russian troops who had no idea what was going to happen. And many of them were captured and put in concentration camps and basically starved to death. And many of them went into what happened to be, luckily for them, forest in Eastern Europe, and swamps in Eastern Europe, and they hid there. And this has really happened in the spring of 1941 through the end of 1941. It becomes around 1942, 1943, around 1942, and the Nazis now are starting to, all the part of Poland that used to be Russia, they are now putting all the people in ghettos, the Jews in ghettos, and they are liquidating, which is just a terrible word, it really just means murdering, all of the populations there. And what happened was, is that at that time, because of the misinformation and the Jews going to a work camps, there's actually a story that I find unbelievable. The Nazis, I think, had the nerve to have people who are going to be sent to a work camp, which really means they're going to be killed the next day. And they gave them pieces of paper and stamps for postcards. And they said, why don't you write letters to your friends and family? And just, you know, here, it's a freebie. We'll even pay for the postage. Wow, that's great. So people wrote, you know, dear Aunt so-and-so, this isn't bad, we're going to a work camp, we're going to make uniforms, and they signed it. Well, the time Aunt so-and-so got it, this person was dead. And so people would get these postcards, and they say, what do you mean Jews are being murdered? I got a postcard. She says she's working. I don't believe what you're saying. This is in her handwriting. So many times, not until the ghetto was being liquidated, till people were, the gates were really closing, did many people escape, and they also went into this incredible forest and swamps where they could hide. And it really was at the very end, because people had no reason to really believe the end was going to happen. No one felt they were going to be murdered. Why would they murder 6 million people? In fact, no one knew everybody was going to be killed. So you had these Jews running into the forest where there happened to be many, many, many Russian soldiers, officers, men and women. And they went there, and for the most part, the Russian groups, what kind of government was, is what we had at this time? Communists, right. And communism, for the most part, it was okay to have Jews and even women in command. So the Jews would get there and they weren't as anti-Semitic to them. They said, Jews are coming in, this guy has a gun, this guy can fight, we'll let him join our group. And so the first partisans, and it's very important, all the partisans weren't Jews, because partisan just means an underground resistance fighter. A lot of the partisans were Russians, and a minority percent, approximately, in Eastern Europe, were Jews. So the Jews would escape from the ghetto, and they would run in and they'd find these Russian groups. Many times they would join, they were allowed to join these groups, like I said, the story of Murray. In other times, there was so much anti-Semitism going on there. We have a biography on our website, which I don't expect anyone to download, but that's okay anyway, a man named Frank Bleichman. And Frank was a platoon commander of over 400 Jews. And they decided, instead of joining a Russian, they'd have 400 Jews together, and they were really powerful. Because at the same time, there were people fighting against the Nazis in these groups. There was also a lot of anti-Semitism. And if you can believe it, there were non-Jewish partisans hunting and trying to find the Jewish partisans, and they would kill them. Many partisans, there's an image I think in the video of a man on the horse at the very end. There's, that's Abe Asner, just as a side, Ed Asner, the actor, there he is, it's his first cousin. And Abe, there were four Asner brothers, and two of his brothers were murdered, not by the Nazis, but by other partisans who hated Jews, because they were so anti-Semitic. So the Jews not only had to fight the Nazis, they had to fight the local population who wanted them dead. And so, getting back to your question, I know this is in a very roundabout way, but what happened was, is that as the wars progressed, 1942, 1943, the partisans are really doing well. They're blowing up the infrastructure. So if you can imagine, you know, on a map, you have Russia over here on the east and Stalingrad, and you had Germany, and Germany had to bring supplies all the way over to the front. And so as the partisans could blow up trains and infrastructure and bridges, it slowed down the war effort. And around 1943, the Russians are saying, wait a second, we have all these people here and they're on our side, so we can help them. So they started to give them airdrop, and it's very, very important. Does anybody else have any other questions? Okay, so let me go on. So, it's important to realize that the Jews made up only a small population of the, it made up a small part of the population of the partisans, but they did a lot. According to Lithuanian figures, Jews made up about 10% of the entire family. All their cousins, brothers, mothers, fathers, uncles, aunts were killed. And so what they really, and as Sonia talked, she said, if I was going to be killed, I want to be killed as a fighter, right? Not as a Jew. You're not going to kill me because I'm Jewish. You're going to kill me because I'm fighting back. And this made a really, really big difference. Let me talk about some of the missions. So the partisans' ultimate goal was to sabotage the Nazi efforts as they fought against Russia. And then those then would explode. So as the Nazis then, so they went back and forth and back and forth. They also, we talked about food. A lot of the Nazis would get food. They wouldn't bring necessarily food in all the way from Germany. That's really ineffective, right? They would bring food in from the local population. They would work. And there was a lot of locals who really wanted the Nazis to win. So they would give them food. There were also a lot of locals who had no choice but to supply the Nazis, or they would be killed, or their farms would be taken away. So the locals had a very difficult position to be in. And the partisans would try to stop that. One of the ways they found some farmers who were sympathetic to the Nazis and kept on feeding them, kept on giving them food. So on one day in 1943, the partisans in Poland lit a line of fire in the fields for 4 or 5 kilometers. One ribbon of fire going across the entire farmland to show the farmers that they cannot cooperate with the Nazis out there. And so I want you to think about which one you guys would rather see by a show of hands, and then we're gonna show one of these clips. I should say that when I was inspired to start this organization, the goal was to interview 50 surviving partisans and do extensive interviews, the interviews that have never been done before. We would do about 3.5 hours of interviews with each partisan, not focusing on what happened after the war, but what they were like as kids. What were they like when they were growing up and what their experiences were in the, we completed these films. So let me see, a show of hands for food. A show of hands for winter and night. A show of hands for medicine. A show of hands for shelter. I think it's winter and night. It's close though. Okay, if we could please show that and then we'll come back. Thank you.
In theory, you can click on
it. And this guy who is a veterinarian in Poland. And in Poland there's a lot of anti-Semitism, so you gotta be careful who you're talking to. And the vet says, I really can't help you. This is more than I can really help. There's another doctor somewhere else, but this guy doesn't really like Jews. And if he knows that you're Jewish, he might kill you, he'll turn you in. So Norman sees this guy pretending he's not Jewish. And the doctor says, I need to give you a shot. Please pull down your pants. Was a Jewish man, he was circumcised. Away. So he knew that if he did that, he would be given away and he could be, you know, very difficult position to put it lightly. And so Norman takes out a grenade and pulls out the pin and says, I'm going to pull down my pants and give me a shot, but basically no funny business, we're both going to get it. I mean, the basic necessities that we think we have here, if it was a non-Jewish partisan, they could get medical help, no problem. The Jewish partisans had to rely on vets and people who were sympathetic, and most of the time, even something like penicillin, they did not have. All right, are we closer? Okay, let me just go to the website then. Can we do that? Try it one more time. Click on Winter and Night and see if we can get to work. Hey, good job.
Winter's bad weather brought more difficulties to the partisans.
The snow, you can't walk in the snow. Sometimes 2-3 feet high snow. And you leave traces when you walk.
So we had to walk in different directions to confuse the enemy, so the enemy will not know where we are situated.
We used to go backwards. We learned to land on tracks.
Jewish partisans struggle to keep warm with inadequate clothing. Many only wrapped rags around their feet for shoes.
That was the fiercest winter of 1942. It was very, very cold, and he just went out with what we had on.
I stood guard once in winter with just a shirt made out of silk from a parachute. That's cold.
You're soaking wet. Take a shower, you never bathe, you stink. You're unreal. 40 below zero, 30 below zero. It's tough. You cannot hold your gun in your hand because the hand freezes to the gun. Tough.
My legs were burned completely because it was so cold when we sat in front of the fire. I did not feel that my flat hair.
You know, we were slipping in the frost and freezing rain. In storm, in snow, on the snow. The snow covered us up. In the morning I got up was a blanket of snow.
Sometimes we used to cuddle up to each other, and just for the warmth of it. In the morning it was, you know, it was cold in our country.
Very often we slept with animals, and they put up a lot of heat.
To survive in it.
I could not have any blanket all this time. We hit some Germans when they were retreating, and two of them they were killed. I see a blanket behind him. So grabbed his blanket, and that was the best present that I ever got.
But the bad weather also had advantages.
But the winter gave us AC, because when you looked outside the area in which we were encamped, you could see footprints, you could see if people were walking there. So we really felt safer, even so we were a lot colder.
The worst conditions were, better it was for us.
We only walked at night because it was dangerous for us to walk during the day, because the Germans were around, the Polish anti-Semites were around.
So the night, the blizzard, heavy snow, heavy rain, this was our friends.
The night is protective. A mother protects your children, the night will protect us. The night is our mother.
Partisan groups in Ukraine going further east were probably in the thousands, rather the Sri Lanka. And what's interesting about this is that, check it out. So this is a structure, you can look on the ground, that is a chessboard used with potatoes. There's a great book, if anybody likes, is anybody interested in this subject, and maybe you might assign it next year for the reading. It's called The Defiant by Shalom Iran. And Shalom basically, in the winter of 1942, and has anybody ever been to Chicago in the winter? It's pretty, basically this part of Poland was equal to being Chicago in the winter, but the coldest winter in 100 years. It was freezing. And so in the winter of 1942, 43, Shalom and four other guys, all in their teens, all probably your age or a little younger, built this, which is a zemlanka. It's a Russian word for dugout. And we basically built this, and you can see directives, different views. So I click here, we can actually see it from the back here. And so we built a very, very talented modeler, and we built a 3D model of the zemlanka based on Shalom's description in his book, The Defiant. And you can look back here, and you can see, it's hard to see. Can we turn off the lights for a sec? Let me see if we can do this. But you can see these are potatoes in the back here. And then there's some onions where the five of them slept. Then this is the back area. And when they did this, they had to get logs. And they just couldn't cut down all the trees because people would know where they were, right? So they had to cut trees from very, very far away and kind of randomly, and then take this. And then when they dig the dirt, because it's half above ground and half underground, the dirt had to be brought far, far away to actually make that work. And I'll show you actually, what do you guys, is it a, we're trying to, but so you'll never, you know, hopefully no one will ever have to build one of these shells, but it'll kind of show you what the experience was like and try to make something as accurate as possible. And to look at a picture of what one of these guys look like from the outside, a lot of these pictures were taken after the war. Because imagine taking a still camera out in the Partisans. Hey, no. Isn't that an interesting clip? So they really had to build it in such a way from an engineering perspective that if it rained, they would not get wet. Shalom talks about when it started to thaw out, they got a lot of water that was dripping. This is actually an excerpt from the movie
Many
they have
Partisans
on
built
shelter.
Underground bunkers called zemlankas.
Half buried in the ground and half of them above the ground. And there were fires going 24 hours a day inside to keep
trees to for support
Once the bunker was dug, we had to put in to hold down the ceiling, and the ceiling also was just wood. So this was a terrible war.
In one bunker, you could sleep maybe 25 people or so.
So if one turned, everybody had to turn, because it goes with it. One legs on top of the other.
Isn't that a great image? I mean, it's being like packed as sardines. And there's something else that just to show if you're interested
in the ditch. An important chore was emptying the bathroom bucket. It was done frequently so there would be no stink added to the other discomforts we had to live with.
So you saw there's a few buckets you saw in there. So this is actually, Larry was, he was nice enough to actually, he's been very involved in our work, and he actually read clips from Shalom's book, The Defiant. So I'd both recommend reading his book if you're interested in it, but also if you're just interested in the Sri Lanka and living and surviving, Larry reads clips from that. How old he was in this picture? Yeah, 15. It's amazing. That was actually a good answer. And so here on this, this is the area where he was active as a partisan. And we have more of this here. And you could read a little short, it's about a 300-word bio about him. That's what he looks like today. There's a few women who work with me in the office thinks that he's really good looking and wanted to, in the picture. But it's actually here. So we have clips here. So which clip do you want to see from?
Never spoke German again.
All right. Here we go.
I dislike the Germans. As I mentioned many times, I spoke German fluently. I had learned it in school and so on, and I knew it fluently. After the end of the war.
So these are little shorts we have. So, and it's actually interesting. You can actually go online and you can look at questions that people have. I gotta figure this out. Have asked. One question was asked. I did a lecture to some high school students, and someone asked, and they couldn't ask it in class. What do the girls do about their period? Really good question. You're not going to ask in class if you're 14 years old. Maybe it's easier college age. But so questions like you're dying to do. So should we ask a partisan question? I should say there's not a partisan standing online. You know, they're not. If someone wants to ask a question, we can ask a question and we can submit it back as a class. What do you think? Should we? So basically, who is going to be the victim? Who wants to put it in here? We need a volunteer. We're going to send it back to someone. Answer.
Okay, Myrna. MYRNA. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for my students.
Well, we can't get an N.
Well, MYR.
MYRA.
MYRA.
A. Oh, there it is. Good.
Okay. Well, keep it personal, hey, email.
goodman@sonoma.edu.
Goodman. Just basically lets us know, are you your teacher? And so here we go, submit.
Ah, it's important to see this wire. After all that, hopefully it's still wired to the site.
Here we go. Let's see if it works. Anyway, it should have gone to do the demo. Well, I appreciate your patience. So just, but we can, but anyway, there's some really wonderful things here. That there's the short films that we just saw online. You can't see. And you can look at all the films that we saw in the on the website as well, and you can also download study guides and other information. So let's turn back on the lights.
Lauren?
Thank you.
Awesome. Does anybody have any questions besides spelling? Thank you.
How did they organize, like, were there leaders, elected leaders to organize the people? Because, I mean, like, how did they get everybody to do what they were going to do and say who was going to do what?
That's a really good question. Were the leaders organized? How were they chosen? A lot of it really had to do with people would have natural leadership and fell asleep on guard. They literally could be shot for that because everybody's life is in danger. If people wanted to take a couple days leave and go into a village, sometimes someone might have a romantic relationship with someone in a village, and they stole an extra day, they could also be punished. So they were run like military units very, very, very strictly. Any other questions? Yes. In terms of what?
Or
trial. These people would, you know, they would be interrogated and many times they would be killed because there was not that kind of infrastructure to take care of them. And it's also wartime. Any other questions?
Yeah? There are a fair number of women who were represented and they grew up in a different time. Do any of them reflect this going outside the boundary of the traditional roles of women at the time? Do they talk about that?
Well, it's very interesting. Women and partisans is actually very fascinating. It's a very interesting subject to me. Just elaborate a little on that first. We're actually developing a study guide, a print study guide of 3,000 words about women and the partisans, and so that'll be out in a couple months, and if you're more interested, you can go to the website and you can download it. Firstly, women were about 10% of the partisan population. They had a much, much, much more difficult time than men. Unfortunately, that, you know, men seem physically stronger. Some women were taken advantage of. When Sonia, it's actually a great, when Sonia comes in to the group for the first time, it's actually really interesting. She'll say it better than I will, hopefully. When Sonia comes in, you see that the commander basically says,
I was called in to actually.
She's 16 years old.
Commander's wife. And she talked to me. I was a youngster, sheltered, did not go out, didn't have any boyfriends or anything of the sort. And she started talking to me. She said to me, you're a young girl. There are very few women in the partisans. And I would advise you to select for you. And this is my advice, and you'll listen to my advice. I opened my eyes wide. I didn't know what she was talking about. And I couldn't understand what she wanted of me. And we just let it go. That's it.
Now, Sonia was very lucky in that she, excuse me, her uncle was a tracker in the army. And Sonia and her mom and dad and uncle were living together outside in the woods for about a year.
And then the phone came to us and he said, look, there are rumors. There are partisans, Russian partisans, in the vicinity. But I don't know whether they're friendly to Jews. They might kill you. But I might talk to them, perhaps they'll accept you. And we said, well, we have nothing to lose. Waited a long time, actually. And then came out a commander for political affairs. Looked at us. Skeletons were sitting there for skeletons, dirty, long hair, overgrown, and he started asking questions. He says, so where are your weapons? We didn't have any weapons. So how many trains did you dynamite? We didn't. So I thought he was not going to take us in, that my uncle was a trained scout. They needed a scout and to lead them in the vicinity where the partisans were. There were strangers in that part of the country. So they took us in because of my uncle.
So because of her uncle, they were allowed to join the group. And her uncle, unfortunately, was killed in an action about 3 or 4 weeks after they were in. But they still let them join the group. Sonia, we'll see, but Mira, that's her with a goat, that's just a cute picture of her sheep. She ended up meeting her husband, who was the partisan commander in an all-Jewish group. Now she, when she escaped the ghetto to join the partisan group, she heard they were partisans there. And what did she do? She and her sister were basically, late teens, and they went to the partisan group, and they said, sure, ladies, you can join the group. And she ended up falling over her husband, and that kind of went happily ever after. But they were lucky. And they went in and she said, my parents are now left the ghetto and they're going to be in a work camp and they're going to be killed. And so because of the relationship they had with the partisans, they let them in. And they were allowed the parents were allowed to come in. Unfortunately, her parents never made it and were killed later.
As I remember, we stayed at one place and we had one partisan who was supposedly watching. We were all asleep.
But this is a good one.
We were all asleep at the peasant's house. And one partisan was outside watching. If the Germans don't approach us, it's actually not the Germans, but the local police.
Which were
the Germans were afraid to get into the forest because you're feeling that each tree is shooting at you. They attacked the house and then we counterattacked them and they ran away. But the partisan who was guiding, the house, they killed the leaders of the partisans. Because how could he know that everybody was asleep? He was watching us. And he got into the house, and he also was like that, going to sleep a little bit.
I know it doesn't answer that directly, but it talks about, the idea. And it's really hard to be in that mind. Why would you kill someone in a group if you need everybody? But if the person, people could have been killed with that. I think these are the site just went up live last night, so apologize if this, I think these two were switched.
But no thanks, women would get to nothing in common. So they would be together during the war, but after the war, they separated. I was lucky enough that I loved my husband, and he loved me. And it was like a love affair in the forest. Can you ask for a better place? So we were lucky that we got together and we promised each other that we'll be together forever.
It's a great story. There's another, we don't have her clip up yet, a woman named Gertrude, and I said if you're interested in this, she has a wonderful, in the study guide section, let's see if there's more, Gertrude Bayarski. So you can click on one of these, and in theory, is download a PDF file. We'll see if this works. And Gertrude has a great story. She was about 17, 18 years old, and she was with a Russian group. And when you're in a Russian group, you celebrate Russian National Women's Day, and what are they going to do? They're like 17, 18 years old, say, why don't we burn down that Nazi bridge down in that village? And they say, okay, and the commander says, all right, I need proof if you do this. So they say, fine. So they two go, girlfriends go out, and they get some kerosene, and they get some straw from the local village, who doesn't want us to help them, so they have to do it by gunpoint, because the village doesn't want to be responsible, don't want to be doing this collaborating with the partisans. And they burn down the bridge, and the Nazis are across shooting at them, and they're returning fire until the bridge is burned down. They take a burnt piece of the bridge, Women's Day, and she was given a Medal of Lenin at the end of the war because of that action. So there's a lot of diversity. I think it's very important. Not one story, as of the approximately, my family are over 30,000 Jewish partisans, not 50, but over 30,000. And there are 30,000 individual stories. So what I'm just talking here today are some snapshots. We can make some generalizations like women in the partisans, but each one different. Everybody had a different experience. But Gertie has a great story, and later, in the coming weeks, we're gonna put some of her video online. And I recommend, if you're interested in it, to check it out. Does anybody have any other questions? Well, since it's such a nice day, should we wrap up? I'm going to hand over the reins. Anyway, thank you so much for having me. in Poland. For more information, www.jewishpartisans.org. So I'm going to leave these back here if anybody would like to take them. And thank you.
Thank you, Mitch.
Yes, I can see that.